Morning. It is a privilege to minister God's word this morning. Please open with me to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. And we'll read verses 1 through 6 this morning. And I would encourage you to hear these words in light of the Lord's Supper that is coming up at the end of our time, as we prepare our hearts to receive again the grace of God through remembering Christ, His body broken for us and His blood poured out for us. Hear the word of the Lord once again. The Apostle John said this, "My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And by this we know that we have come to know Him, if we keep His commandments. And whoever says, 'I know Him,' but does not keep His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps His word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. And by this we know that we are in Him. Whoever says he abides in Him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked." Lord, once again, use your word and help us to see that we are in you, if we abide in your truth and we abide in you. Amen. Well, the Olympics are underway. Maybe you've been following along. And maybe you've heard that speed walking is coming up on August 5th. Did you know that? You probably did. You probably didn't, actually. Speed walking. Not quite the same draw and excitement and anticipation as the 4x100 meter relay or the 4x4 or the 200 meter dash. Walking isn't as spectacular or as swift as running, isn't it? Well, that's probably why you didn't know that it was coming up, but it is. Now you know. Mark your calendar. But John's metaphor of walking in the book of 1 John is instructive for us. It's helpful for us. There's certainly language in the New Testament about running the race and striving and straining forward to reach the goal. But walking in the book of 1 John and in Paul's writings in Ephesians 2, you remember that we're called to, in verse 10, walk in good works. We're to pay careful attention to how we walk. Well, what is this language of walking? Well, walking, when you tell your children in the parking lot, "Walk next to me," or "Stay on the sidewalk." Don't walk near the street. Walking is a sure and a steady movement in one direction, right? It's progress toward a goal. You know, when you're walking through the parking lot at Costco with your children from the car to the entrance, you say, "Okay, you see the entrance over there? That's where we're going. Look both ways before we cross. Stay right next to me and let's walk together." There's a goal. There's an end point, a destination that you're seeking to reach. But again, it's not spectacular. It's not flashy. Walking is just walking, right? No one ever says, "Wow, look at how that guy walks. That's amazing. That's incredible. Look at his posture and look at his stance, and then he's leaning forward." And no one speaks about walking like that. I suppose if you're into speed walking, you might pay attention to those things. But walking is intentional steps of dependence and, in the Christian life, daily submission to God. That's what walking in John, in the letters of John, is referring to, a dependence, a steady walk of dependence upon the Lord, submission to God, and in our text this morning, obedience to His word. The walk that John describes in our text is not perfect like Christ. It is not a flawless walk. It is not a flawless submission or obedience or dependence upon God, but it is a seeking to please Him in our thoughts and in our words and in our deeds. Let me say that again. It's not perfect. It's not perfection like Christ, but in light of Christ's work on our behalf, His perfect death, His acceptable death, His sufficient and spectacular sacrifice on our behalf, empowers and strengthens and energizes our seeking to be pleasing to Him in our deeds and in our thoughts and in our words. And so far we've seen in 1 John, as we started last month, a series in John, as we kind of work through James, and then we'll do some time in 1 John as Phil and the other elders have given me opportunities to preach on Sunday mornings here. So far we've seen in 1 John that he's concerned for spiritual safety. John isn't just concerned about the believers in the early church and their physical safety, their protection from oppressors, from those who might seek to hurt them, harm them physically. Because John knows that Jesus prayed, "Father, I am not asking that you take them out of this world that is dangerous to Christians physically, certainly, that is treacherous." But John knows that Jesus prayed, "Father, that you would keep them in the world, that you would keep them from the evil one, but that you would send them into the world." And so if we are to be sent into the world, we're going to live in this world with purpose, walking in submission and obedience to God's word, we need spiritual safety and perseverance. And so that's what John is concerned about. He's concerned for the believers. He's concerned for his little children. His little children that he loves with deep affection. You don't speak to someone as a little child and then say the things that John says if you don't love them deeply. He's not condescending. He's getting on his knee and he's saying, "Little children, listen to me. Listen to what I have to say to you as I deliver to you what I've received from the Lord. Little children, I'm writing to you so that you may not sin. And I'm writing to you so that you may know if you know Him. I'm writing to you for your spiritual safety and security. Because there were those who, instead of seeking God's glory by helping people live holy lives, they wanted to get people to do things their way by following some other rules instead of God's word and Christ's example, to get glory and attention on themselves. Those who were saying that there's a secret knowledge that is a superior spiritual knowledge, because spiritual transcends the physical. And yet what John is concerned about is that their whole lives, that their spiritual lives that are worked out in the day-to-day of their lives, would conform to the life of Christ. Not to man's standards, but to Christ. And so, last month we saw another tremendous truth, that not only does John want the believers to remember that it is Jesus that they are following. Remember, John said that Christ is the one that they have heard and saw with their eyes and looked upon and touched with their hands concerning the word of life. Because this life was made manifest and they had seen it, and they are now testifying to it and proclaiming that there's eternal life in Him. Not only did we see that, but that Jesus paid a great price to bring sinners to God. And this is what it means, that Jesus was the propitiation for our sins. This word that describes Christ bearing and absorbing and taking upon Himself the full wrath of God. Not merely a deflection of God's wrath, but that God, who is just, poured out His full wrath for sin upon his own son, who is God himself, who was able to receive the blow and therefore satisfy the wrath of God. Jesus paid this great price to bring sinners to God. And now he is our advocate. He took on wrath so that we might know peace. And now John has said that he stands in heaven with the Father so that when the Father looks at those, this is the result of Christ's propitiating work, that those who trust in Christ's wrath-absorbing work, that God looks on them in a special way. God sees the righteousness of Jesus deposited into their empty bank account, an outside righteousness that now belongs to us. And God sees us sinners through the Savior, the righteous one. And so what does John want in light of that work, in light of the fact that God looks on us as his own, wrapped up with the righteousness of Christ, battling sin and struggling and yet still declared righteous? John's desire is that they would be secure and certain and assured of their salvation. And so he gives believers tests of their assurance. He gives them a plain and clear sign that someone is a believer. And in this text this morning, we will see two ways in which John desires to assure, to give certainty to these believers in light of and in view of the false teaching that was surrounding them, in view of the doubts that our hearts can encounter as we struggle with sin and we say, I thought I was a Christian. I thought I was supposed to live a holy life. What gives? John wants to assure the hearts of believers, not to excuse them, not to make light of their sin, not to make light of their struggles with sin, but to give them hope in view of the finished work of Christ. And so here's maybe a big idea or a main point for us this morning. It's this: that true Christians gladly keep God's word and imitate Christ. True Christians, a true Christian is someone who is assured, who is enjoying the assurance of their salvation. And what are those people? They are those who gladly keep God's word and imitate Christ. And so let's see the first of those in verses 3 and 4. The first part of that is that we are, as God's people, meant to be assured by obedience. Look at verse 3 again. And we'll look at verses 3 through 6 this morning. He says, and By this, so by what? Well, he says, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. So if you want to know how it is that someone comes to know God, what is the evidence that someone knows God? It's that they are concerned about and care for the commandments of God. And so by this, John wants to remind them, to assure them, that obedience is a certain sign of the new birth, of new life. And so a question we might ask is this: do you strive by God's grace to keep God's commands? Do you, by God's grace, strive to keep God's commands? Because that's what John's getting at. He says, by this we know that we have come to know him. That something has happened in the past that you, by which you came to know and have a relationship. That's what it means to know God. Not to just know intellectual things about him, but that you have come to know him in a real and a loving and a relational kind of way where you share fellowship with God. Something happened in the past, and it has had ongoing, continual effects even until now. Believers are assured by their obedience. Another way of saying that is that lovingly obeying God's commandments is evidence that we know him. And the word lovingly, I mean that, and that's an important word. We could just say obeying God's commands is evidence that we have come to know him, and that's true. In fact, that's what John says. But the implication to know someone, let me ask you this, husbands and wives. If I were to say, hey, do you love your wife? Do you love your husband? You say, well, of course I do. Yeah, I know. I love my husband. I love my wife. But how would someone know that? How would your spouse know that you love them? Well, they will know that you love them by the way that you treat them, the way that you care for them, the way that you live with them. Does the way that you live with them and the way that you care for them show that you have affection for them? Similarly, if we say that, and the reason is because there is a loving relationship there. If we're to say that we know God, and God is a person who made us for his glory to live with him as Adam and Eve did, to walk with him, to enjoy fellowship as creature to creator, then to know God is far more than just to have a list of facts or Bible verses that we can recite, but to have a relationship with him. And if marriage, as a picture, is an example of how God loves sinners through his Son, then to know God is to have a loving relationship, like we see depicted in the metaphor of marriage. And so obeying God's commands is not just rote and dry and robotic, but it is loving. It is affectionate. And John makes it clear here that in order for a person to be sure about their salvation, it will have a certain flavor to it. Their salvation and their relationship to God will have a certain scent to it. It will have an aroma that is the aroma of love. And to explain what a person who is assured by obedience looks like, John makes a contrast between striving, those who are striving to love and to obey God, and those who are deceived. Look at what he says in verse 3 again. By this we know that we have come to know him. And here's the way that we know, if we keep his commandments. But then verse 4, he says this, whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a what? A liar. And the truth is not in him. The truth is not in him. God wants his people to know that they know. To know and to be certain that they have and enjoy a relationship with God. He wants them to be sure that they have truly come to know him and that they will never lose him. And he uses the word know twice in this sentence and in some form 40 times throughout the whole book of 1 John. So what do you think John wants his hearers to know? He wants them to know God, and he wants them to enjoy confidently that they belong to him, that he is theirs and that they are his, and that relationship, that tie will never be severed. The phrase, have come to know, that we have come to know, shows that something, again, happened in the past, but it didn't just happen and then stopped. We didn't just pray a prayer or confess something or say something to a priest or a pastor and say, well, okay, sure, I'll be a part of the team. I'll go to church. That seems good to me. That seems like a good way to live. Christians are nice people. No, he says that we have come to know. It shows something that didn't just happen and stop, but what John is referring to is the time that they first became obedient to God by following after Christ. He's referring to a time that they had first embraced Christ as the forgiver of sins and as the King of their lives. And there's ongoing realities connected to their salvation, namely that they are currently striving to obey God's word. And this is what it means that Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord means that what he says goes, and we love to do what he says. And so, do you love to do what he says? Do you search God's word to find what he wants for you? If you're asking the question, what is God's will for my life? How am I supposed to live? The answer is in God's word. Obedience to God is obedience to God's word. Look at verse 4. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Verse 5, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. Beloved, if you find yourself in cycles and in circles of disobedience, and you find that you don't know how to overcome sin and temptation, it's likely that God's word is not front and center in your life. If you find that you keep going back and back and back to the same sins over and over with unbroken patterns, could it be that God's word has not become a treasure to you, a life-giving and life-sustaining resource that contains all of the wisdom and the knowledge of God for obedience and for joy? And if you're struggling with assurance and you wonder, am I even a Christian? I would wager to bet, if I was a betting man, that it's probably because God's word sits on the table, or it only comes out on Sunday mornings, and 6 out of 7 days of the week, it is not being infused into the bloodstream of your life like God desires, for your joy and for your assurance and for your confidence that you're growing. Those who are striving to enjoy fellowship with God are those who are striving to love God's word. And you will not enjoy fellowship and relationship with the Lord if God's word is not front and center in your life. And so John is looking back to the time that they were rescued from their life of sin, rescued out of the death camp of their sin, and into the loving arms of God. And as a result, they are what? What does he say? He says, they are keeping. Look at verse 4. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is not keeping his commandments, is a liar. Another way to translate keeping is to be watching. And the idea is to be obeying. If we keep is a challenge, that phrase, if we keep, is a challenge to every professing believer. John is saying, if you claim to know God, listen to this, if you claim to know God, and you claim that he's changed you and transformed your heart and life, are you following his commands? It's pretty straightforward, isn't it? That's pretty hard language for the apostle of love. But it's straightforward so that we won't be confused, so that we'll know. They'll know for sure. And so he uses the word keep in verses 3 and in verses 4 and in verses 5 to give the idea of being watchful. Are we keeping his commandments? Are we being watchful over his word that we might do it? It has the idea of being attentive to something, of keeping guard over something, to being watchful for God's commands so that we might say, Lord, whatever you say to do in your word, I will do it. It's the picture of a soldier who's been given the task of keeping guard, of keeping watch through the night. He's been tasked with the job of keeping watch for the enemy that may be approaching. And he has high attentiveness. He's got his eyes on the horizon. He's got his binoculars out. He's got his night vision on. And he's looking. He's watching. He's waiting. Now we're talking about watching and waiting and looking for the good things in God's word, the commands of God that are satisfying to us because he's our master and we're his slaves. He's our father. And we're his sons and daughters. And he's a loving father. And we say, Lord, Father, whatever you say, I will do it. You have been good to me. I will watch and I will do because you're worthy of it. And so just as a soldier might be listening for snapping twigs of the feet walking through the forest or the rustling of leaves, keeping his eyes peeled for every little movement. So we are those watching in God's word to say, Lord, what your word says, I will do it because I love your commands. Because in your commands, I see your heart. I see what you love. And what you love, I love. And what you hate, I hate. And when you say go, I will go. And where you say I must stop because the dangers of sin, I will stop. I don't want to go on into sin because how could I? I've been purchased. I've been bought with a price. I want to glorify you with my body and with my life. But again, in verse 4, remember what he says, whoever says I know him, but does not keep, does not watch, does not guard his heart and his mind for the commandments of God. He says he is a liar and the truth is not in him. And so, God wants to know, are you loving his commandments? Or, church, are we lying? Are we those who say, oh yeah, I love God, but by our lives we resist him? We reject him, we refuse him, and so as we do that, of course we're not enjoying the assurance and the rest and the peace and the joy that comes from knowing God and the security of knowing his commands. Because we say one thing on Sunday, but we live lives that are contrary during the week. And so, verse 5 clarifies for us. The first part of verse 5 says this, clarifies for us again. Look at the text. Whoever keeps his word, whoever keeps and watches and obeys his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. Now what does he mean by that? What does he mean that the love of God is perfected? Does that mean that you're a perfect Christian? Does that mean that your love for God is perfect, flawless? Of course not. Of course not. In fact, the language of the text is that the work of something being perfected is that it's something being completed, something that's being brought to completion or maturity. And in fact, the verb is passive. That means you're not doing it. God has been the one who's done this thing. And it was done in the past. And it has continuing effects that God's love towards you is being perfected. It means that what God set to accomplish in saving you has been completed. If you're a Christian, your desire is to obey God's word. His work to save you was a work to cause you to love his commands and to love his words, and his work was effective. And so again, the challenge for us is, do we love God's word and do we love his commands? Do we seek out his commands and his word like treasure? The psalmist puts it this way. He describes the heart and the life and the love of a believer who loves God's commands. Listen to these words. And does this describe us, church? The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. If your heart is not rejoicing, it could be that God's word has become dull to you, has become lame, has become boring. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes, the fear of the Lord. In other words, a love for God's word because you hate sin and you want to live for the Lord. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. They are more to be desired than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than what? Honey. And drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. And so God's love is brought to his perfect plan, its perfect end, when his saints are striving to obey his word. That was the end goal of God's love in saving you, was that you would love to walk with him. That language of walking in his word, in verse 6, we'll get to in a moment, is walking hand in hand with the Lord, saying, Lord, where you go, I will go. When they're striving to steer clear of the soul-crushing and joy-destroying enticements of sin and seeking to know and do the will of God from his word. And brothers and sisters, I'm a fellow struggler. I'm tempted with the same temptations as you. I need you to help me just as you need me and others to help you keep striving after Christ. You were not saved in a vacuum. You were saved into a family, walking together. And so as we've heard from James recently, we need to be willing to confess our sins, our struggles, as our walk is being hindered, as we're stumbling and struggling along the way. God has not left us to walk alone, but to look to his word together as fellow strugglers striving to please Christ and seeking to know and to do the will of God. And so we don't want to be those who are self-deceived, who say that we know God but are not following his word. And I want to just speak to those who are maybe going, yeah, whatever, God's word. I memorized a bunch of verses and it's really not that big of a deal. Listen to what John says. Friend, if you are refusing to submit yourself to the word of God daily, John says you are a liar. And the consequences of being found a liar before the God of the universe is devastating. God knows the truth. He knows all things. He knows the heart of man. You cannot deceive God. You cannot trick God. And so today, if you are living in refusal to obey God's word or neglecting God's word, today is a day for you to repent and to turn and to renew your heart and your love before the Lord. And to enjoy and to receive the sweet assurance that he gives to those who love him and to love to do what he says. Remember, 1 John 3. Rather, 1 John 5, verse 3. Listen, this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and what? His commandments are not burdensome. Brothers and sisters, his commands are not a burden, but they lift the burden. They lift the burden of striving to be someone that you're not. You're not perfect. And so you need the grace and the rest and the peace of Christ that comes as you run to him and say, Lord, I know I'm not perfect. I need you to strengthen me, to lift the burden of my sin and of my struggling. Will you help me? And what he will do is send you to his word for the comfort that you need. He'll send you to his commands that are the safety that you need to keep from wandering off into sin and to wandering off into the world, like John says in verse 15, that is passing away. So cry out to him, friend. Cry out to him today if you find yourself wondering, am I one of those who've been self-deceived, saying that I'm something that I'm not. Like a man who says he loves his wife but refuses to care for her and serve her and submit to her and to lead her, refuses to comfort her and to encourage her, not perfectly. Don't be like that man. The second thing that we see is John wants to assure the hearts of his hearers is this. Not only are we assured by our obedience to God's word, but John wants to assure them by their imitation of Christ. In verses 5 and 6, look again at the text. Verse 5, the second part is this. He says, chapter 2, verse 5, by this we know that we are in him. And he's pointing to verse 6. By this we know that we are in him. That's common, glorious language to describe those who are in fellowship and relationship with Christ. Those who are in him are these. Whoever say they abide in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Walking with Jesus is a display that we are in him. We're assured by our imitation of Christ. Those who are born again, they walk with Christ. Those who enjoy new life are those who walk with Christ. And so John gives us one more rock-solid way to know that we are having fellowship with God. He says this, again, whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. If you are to live a life that is pleasing to God and one that is constantly striving to obey him, you will be looking more and more like Christ. And so John now equates, listen to this, knowing God. He equates knowing God with abiding in God. He's not merely saying that he is obeying him, but that he is seeking to obey God in, with all of his strength, with all of his heart. He says that by this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him, not only walks in him, but seeks to stay in him and to set up a tent so as to dwell with God, to live with God. He says he ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. So living and abiding with God is walking with God. It's describing, again, the way of your life, the way in which you go about existing is seeking to be like Christ. And so what does that mean? What does that look like? Well, here's some examples. John 6, verse 38, Jesus said, I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. What does that mean? Jesus came not to make decisions based on his own desires and his own thoughts, or to live in ways that were just his own thinking, but to do the will of him who sent him. And so the question for us, how about you? Is that your desire? Is your desire to do the will of your Father? Are you asking God, help me to walk and to make decisions, to make plans, and to think about the future in ways that you would approve of? Jesus said in John 8, 29, he who sent me is with me. Again, this is the kind of thinking and living that someone who is in Christ, this is how they think and live. He who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. Now, we can't say that we are always doing the things that please him. This morning, we've all done things that are not pleasing to him. But here's the question. Is your desire to live a life of obvious obedience so that the world will know that you belong to him, or so that your children will know that you belong to him, or so that your spouse will know that you are in him? Or that your church will know that you are in him? How about you? John 14, 31, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Church, is that our desire, that the world would know that we belong to Him? Is that our desire? Are we speaking and acting in ways that show that we are not of this world? Are we speaking about our governor, about our leaders, about our culture, about our world that shows that we love them and we love Him? Remember the walking illustration. When you're walking somewhere, you have a destination. And the decisions you make along the way are influenced by the end goal. The way that we speak and think and live along the way is influenced by the goal. And what is the goal? It's to be with Christ. It's remembering that Christ is coming to set up His kingdom and that He will rule over this world forever and ever. And we will be with Him. We will be with Him. Are we speaking and living and thinking in ways that show that we know that and that we believe that? Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones sums up these verses like this. Listen to these words. Here's a man who has now reached the end. He's reached the destination. If you have the life, speaking about eternal life, this life that is in Christ, it is bound to show itself. And if it does not, then you have not the life. You cannot be receiving the life of Christ without becoming like Him. And you cannot walk with God without keeping His commandments. You cannot know God without immediately, automatically loving Him. Love always manifests itself by doing what the object of its love desires. Did you get that last part? Love always manifests itself by doing what the object of its love desires. Is that our desire? Is that your desire? Do your desires, as you match them up to the Scriptures, to the Word of God, do they match His desires? When we see a desire in our heart, we should say, type in our desire, enter, compute. Oh, it doesn't match up with God's desires. There's specific commands or verses or passages that instruct me that my desires are off, and so I want my desires to match up with the Lord. And how do we do that? We look to Christ. We look to Christ. And so ask yourself first, here's the first question. Do I know Christ? Do you know Him? Have you trusted in Him as the propitiation for your sins, the one who absorbed the wrath of God and brings you to God? Do you trust Him in that way? And if so, here's the next question. Do you know that you know Him? Are you enjoying assurance of your salvation by obedience to Him? Are you? How do you know that you know Him? Well, the question is, do I obey His word and seek to walk as Jesus walked? Do I obey His word and seek to walk as Jesus walked? We heard at family camp this last week from James chapter 1 that we're to be doers of the word, that the grace of God revealed to us in Christ empowers and energizes our doing, our obedience. One comes first. Life comes, and then the desires come. And so if the desires are not there, the question is, do you have this life? Is that the direction and the focus of your life? And if it is, then you can know that you know Him. Not perfect, not flawless, but if your desire, the cry of your heart is, Lord, I want to know You and follow You and obey You. I want my finances. I want my family. I want my ministry, my work, my plans and my future. I want all of that. The direction and the focus of my life to be so that they would show that I know You. Is that our desire? And so these are the questions that John raises in our passage. John wants us to know that we know. And so two simple tests for us of our faith. Do we love to obey God's commands, church? In other words, are we searching His Word daily? Have we positioned our lives, set up our lives such that we are in fellowship with one another and we are looking in God's Word together to ask, God, what does Your Word call us to do? And secondly, are we looking to Christ as the ultimate example and the goal, the one that we're striving after to imitate? These are the questions that John raises in our passage today. And if we are tempted to be discouraged, if we think that there's no hope, we need to remember 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. If anyone does sin, if anyone sees their desire and their love for God's Word, where He has revealed His heart, falling short, if anyone does sin, if anyone sees that their imitation of Christ is lacking and their life actually looks more like the world, if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father. We have one who is standing before the judge right this very moment saying, remember, remember, oh Father, I took the penalty of their sins on my back. I took the stripes. I took the blow. They're in us. Sanctify them. Shape their hearts. Change their desires. Grow them. They belong to me. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Discouraged saint, look to Christ. Look to Christ. And now we will look to Christ in the Lord's Supper. Brothers and sisters, as we come to this meal, this is a reminder for us that Christ has paid it all. Christ has done it all, and so I want to invite the musicians to come because we're going to sing about the work that Christ has done to cover our sins, to make us new, so that when we are faced with our sin, we're faced with our laziness or our pride or our arrogance or our anger or bitterness or lust or whatever it is, that we have an advocate, we have a helper. And not only Christ, but His Spirit. But how was it accomplished? It was accomplished through the bloody cross. It was accomplished through the work of Christ 2,000 years ago as He was rejected by His own, but was accepted by the Father as the sacrifice for sins. And so let me pray. Take a moment to meditate on these things and to rejoice in these things. And if you're living at peace with God's people and your sins are confessed, this is a time to enjoy God's grace upon you and to receive afresh the blessing of His forgiveness. And so take some time to search your heart, to meditate on these things, and then we'll sing and enjoy the Lord's table together.